Does everybody at least have an idea of how you would go about this? Let's imagine we wanted to take our African lion data set and do a test to see if our models are significant statistically. What would we do? We would, first of all, find a smart way to partition our data. In the paper I just published on African lions, notice that their distribution is kind of this arc like this, right? West Africa, Northeast Africa, South Africa. So in that paper, just kind of looking for a nice trick, I put a point in the Congo Basin and I moved kind of a radial arm across the distribution and I split it into, I think it was three chunks. Okay? But you have to come up with some smart way of partitioning your data. It could be spatially, it could be after filtering to control for spatial autocorrelation, like in the asterisk example. Okay? Lots of options. It could be random under some circumstances. So you partition your data. And then you develop your test statistic and you ask, okay, using these elements to train, these elements to test, how well am I doing? And remember specifically, it's, am I doing significantly better than the random? And to some degree separately, am I doing well enough that it serves the needs of my study? And that will frequently be an omission calculation. That make sense to everybody?
Thank you. I can't seem to pick it up from my laptop, but I read something about carbon, some major partition like that.
That's a very, very good question. Kappa. Kappa is a statistic that's very commonly used. It's called Cohen's Kappa, after the person proposed it. It's very commonly used as an index of correspondence between two sets of numbers. In this case, it might be correspondence between predictions and observations, right? So it's essentially, you can take kappa and apply it to the confusion matrix. If you look at the formula for kappa, it has one failing. That is, that it weights unsuccessful prediction of presences, unsuccessful prediction of absences, it means those two people. So I'm going to give you a classic example of how kappa can be run. Imagine that we have a true distribution of a species that's quite small. And we have a prediction that's quite small. Okay? And we have a million testing. Maybe my prediction and the truth don't even overlap, which is to say, my prediction has 100% omission. But remember, we have a million testing points, and a lot of those are correct prediction absence. So kappa says, wow, we're doing pretty well. Kappa gives you a nice high value, and it's all a function of absence data. Okay? So we really have to be careful with the confusion matrix. B and C are not weighted equally, they are in kappa. And also A and D can't be weighted equally. Right? So that's why I need to mention it. Okay? What kappa is doing is very interesting. It's measuring the predictive performance, taking into account what was expected at random. So remember my whiteboard against the wall, the whiteboard covers 20% of the wall. I expect at random a success rate of 20%. Now, how well am I doing above and beyond that 20%? So kappa expresses that improvement of performance But if you look carefully at it, and if it's a very detailed analysis, kappa is weighting A and B the same, and B and C the same. And that's undesirable. Okay? So you'll see actually quite a few papers appear in the literature. As Richard said, this is a very active area of research as far as how do you test these models. So you see a lot of papers appear in the literature, a new approach to testing model predictions. And for a niche modeling world where we distrust absence data, it's a very easy job to evaluate whether you want to use that statistic or not. You have to ask, is there a way to weight presence data and error related to presence data and success rate related to presence data more than you weight absence data? Okay? That's what it's all about.